At one time or another, we'll go through a time in our lives when we experience troubles. As a matter of fact, there are some days when you think, probably I should have stayed in bed, because not they just start out bad and get progressively worse. I was reading the story of about a fellow who had been hired to repair a chimney. He was on the roof of a building and repairing the chimney, and he ended up getting injured on the job, and so he had to make an insurance claim and report as to how the injury happened. And so he did. And I wanted to read his report as he made it to the insurance company. He put it this way: when I got to the job site, I found that the brick company had delivered the bricks and put them on the roof with their forklift. I began to repair the chimney, and when I finished the job, there were a lot of bricks left over. So, not having a forklift, I rigged up a beam with a pulley at the top of the building and hoisted up an empty barrel to the roof of the building. With the rope secured at the bottom, I filled the barrel on the roof with the extra bricks, and then I went down to the bottom and tied the rope to let the barrel of bricks down. Unfortunately, the barrel of bricks was heavier than I was, and before I knew what was happening, the barrel started down, jerking me off the ground. I decided to hang on. Halfway up, I met the barrel coming down fast, and I received a severe blow on the shoulders. I then continued on to the top, banging my head against the beam and getting my fingers jammed in the pulley. When the barrel hit the ground, it burst its bottom, allowing all the bricks to spill out. I was now heavier than the barrel. I started back down again at high speed. Halfway down, I met the barrel coming back up fast, and I received more injuries to my shins. When I hit the ground, I landed on the bricks, getting several painful cuts from the sharp edges of the bricks. At this point, I must have lost my presence of mind because I let go of the line. And the barrel then came down fast, giving me a very heavy blow in my head and putting me in the hospital. I respectfully request sick leave. Well, I had an experience not that much different to what this bricklayer had a number of years ago. Actually, it was back, I remember the day very specifically, October the 30th, 1995, when I was working on a project and I had to cut a very slender amount of wood off a piece that I was putting in, and we were doing some wainscoting in our kitchen. And I remember going into the garage and thinking, well, you know, I just need just a thin sliver off and then it'll be perfect. Well, I put the board through and it jammed, and I pushed a little harder just to make sure that the board got through, and all of a sudden the saw caught the board and with the board pulled my hand and sliced it open. And you can't see it on the TV, but it cut right all the way down through there, cut through this knuckle entirely, severed these two tendons, and I was in the hospital for the weekend. I had surgery. They said the tendons had snapped back up into my arm, and they had to pull them down, reattach them. And I remember being in 3 or 4 months of physiotherapy after that. Tell you what, that wasn't a fun experience. That was trouble in my life, I'll tell you that. I would later tell people that I'd gotten into a fight with a circular saw and I'd lasted only one round. Well, I want to make this statement. Troubles are a given for life in a fallen, sinful world, even for born-again Christians. Although some of us born-again Christians probably would do better if we used a stick to push the wood through the saw instead of our hands. And a born-again Christian like me should have done that. Unfortunately, I didn't. I like the way the Living Bible translates 1 Peter 4:12. Dear friends, don't be bewildered or surprised when you go through the fiery troubles ahead, fiery trials ahead, for this is no strange, unusual thing that is going to happen to you. In other words, I tell you what, it's unusual if it doesn't happen to you in a sinful, fallen world. The Message translates John 16:33 this way: in this godless world, you will continue to experience difficulties. Acts 14:23, today's English version puts it this way: they strengthen the believers and encourage them to remain true to the faith. And then notice, and I've italicized the final phrase there, we must pass through many troubles to enter the kingdom of God. You see, no one is immune to pain or insulated from suffering, and no one gets to skate through life problem-free. All of us will experience troubles in life. And the key issue then is how we respond to them as those troubles come thundering down the track of life. As one fellow has put it, the acid test of every religion is what it can do for people in the hour of overwhelming trouble. In his book, Good to Great, Jim Collins looks at the discoveries that the International Committee on the Study of Victimization made, and they came up with what they call the hardiness factor. And this is the way Collins puts it in that book. He says this, quote, people generally fell into three categories: those who were permanently dispirited by the event, those who got their life back to normal, and those who used the experience as a defining event that made them stronger. Well, this morning I ask you the question is this: how do you make your trouble your life's defining event? Well, this morning I'm actually beginning a new series of messages. I've chosen the book of James from the New Testament, and I've entitled it The Nuts and Bolts of Christian Living. And you're going to see some of that nuts and bolts in every message throughout the book of James. And a wonderful, marvelous book that it is. The author of the book of James is, of course, a man by the name of James. It says in verse 1, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations, greetings. So this James was actually the half-brother of Jesus, one of at least six siblings that Jesus had. We read in Mark 6:3, the people of Nazareth asking about Jesus, isn't this the carpenter? And they're referring to Jesus here. Isn't this Mary's son? And then notice it lists his brothers. It says James, Joseph, Judah, and Simon. And then notice the next question, and aren't his sisters here with us? They are not named, but notice it uses the plural, so it means he at least had two sisters. So if he had four brothers and at least two sisters, he had six siblings, possibly more. Well, in the first section in James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, that becomes our text this morning, and I've entitled my message, Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen. Well, let's pray as we begin the message. Father, we thank you for your word, and that it teaches us in how to respond to troubles in life when they come our way, and help us to learn this lesson and to apply it. Help us not to be just hearers of the word, but help us to be doers, obediently putting into practice what you want us to. And so I now ask your Holy Spirit to come and minister to us. Satan, I command you and every evil and unclean spirit to go. You have no part, no place in this church building, nor even in this YouTube channel. And I plead the blood of Jesus Christ over us. And I pray that your message, O Holy Spirit, will come deeply into all of our lives. For your honor and glory we pray. Amen. There's a genre of music that was called, back when I was growing up, Negro spirituals. We used to sing a lot of them in the church when I was growing up. Some of them, like this one. Jordan Road, Road, Jordan Road, I want
to get to heaven when I die, to hear old Jordan roll.
Well, that's Roll Jordan Roll. Here's another one. Listen to this one.
Michael rode the boat ashore, hallelujah. Michael rode the boat
ashore. Michael row your boat ashore. And then the third one, listen to this one.
Swing low.
Swing low, sweet chariot. When I was a teenager, we used to sing Swing Low, Sweet Harriet. Then, of course, there's a Negro spiritual, a song that Louis Armstrong sings, Nobody Knows the Trouble I've Seen, and I've used this for my sermon title. And this is Louis Armstrong singing it.
Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows my sorrow. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Glory, hallelujah. Sometimes I'm up, sometimes I'm down. Oh, yes, Lord. Sometimes I'm almost to the ground. Oh, yes, Lord. Oh, nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Jesus. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Glory,
I love that song and the way Louis Armstrong sings it, especially. I like the part when he notices how he keeps his eyes closed as he's singing, but then when he says the word Jesus, he opens up his eyes. Watch how he does that. I'm going to play it again.
See, nobody knows but Jesus. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Glory, hallelujah.
Then I came across this. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. And the cat's there laying on his back. And at the bottom says, or caused or thought about. If you have a cat, you know all about that. Or here's a meme that I came across. Nobody knows the trouble I've seen. Nobody knows but Facebook. Well, when troubles come into our life, whatever the trouble may be, we all have a choice as how we are going to respond to it, how we are going to react to it. You see, we can look at those problems in a very negative manner. First of all, when troubles come into our lives, we can respond in a very common way. The most common way is get mad and to show our displeasure. Proverbs 29:11 says, a fool gives full vent to his anger, but a wise man keeps himself under control. I'll never forget back when I was a lot younger. in my 20s, and I had this red Ventura that I was driving, and I remember one morning it wouldn't start, and I got so mad, so frustrated, so upset at it. I remember kicking it. The only thing that really accomplished was that it hurt my foot. Well, sometimes we can blame God. We think he's made a mistake, and so we blame God for what he's allowed to come into our lives. Proverbs 19:3, the foolishness of man subverts his way, and his heart rages against the Lord. And we rail at God and feel that God has failed us. He's let us down. You know, it's really quite amazing to see how many people blame God for their problems. In his article entitled A Bad Week in Hell in Christianity Today, Philip Yancey tells several experiences that he'd come across in his life. He said this, when Princess Diana died, I got a phone call from the television producer. Can you appear on our show? He asked. We want you to explain how God could possibly allow such a terrible accident. Then he tells back in the 1994 Winter Olympics, when speed skater Don Jansen's hand scraped the ice, causing him to lose the 500-meter race, his wife Robin cried out, "Why, God, again? God can't be that cruel." He says about a professional boxing match where Boom Boom Mancini was in a fight with his Korean opponent, hit him with a punch with his right hand, caused a massive cerebral hemorrhage, and the fellow died. And at the press conference, Mancini said, "Sometimes I wonder why God does the things he does." He tells about a young woman who wrote a letter to James Dobson, and she said in her letter, 4 years ago, I was dating a man and became pregnant. I was devastated. I asked God, why have you allowed this to happen to me? I like the way Philip Yancey responds to that. He concludes by saying, exactly what role did God play in a speed skater losing control on a turn, or a teenage couple losing control in the back seat of a car, of course, or not to mention the lethal effect of a boxer's punch? And as for Princess Diana's accident, could it have something to do with a drunk driver going 85 miles an hour in a narrow tunnel? And yet people blame God. Well, Jonah was very upset at God, and was blaming him for the way he was doing things that he was involved in. You remember God had told him to go to Tarshish and preach to the people there because God had promised judgment upon the Ninevites. Not Tarshish, I'm sorry, I made a mistake. God had told him to go to Nineveh to preach to the Ninevites and tell them to repent of their sins, but he ran instead to Tarshish. That's when he got on board the boat and headed off across the Mediterranean on his way out. Tarshish, a lot of scholars feel, is modern-day Spain. So God had told him to go east, and he ends up going west. And then he comments as he's sitting there waiting for Nineveh to be destroyed. And of course, God doesn't destroy it because the people all repent. And he says, I knew that you are a merciful and compassionate God, patient and always ready to forgive and to reconsider your threats of destruction. What Jonah wanted was for the Ninevites to be destroyed. They were Israel's major enemies, and he thought it would be a great thing if Nineveh was destroyed by God. Well, when God didn't destroy Nineveh but spared it, and he's sitting there on the mountainside waiting it past the 40 days, and it doesn't happen, so he says to God, so now, Lord, take my life. I'd rather be dead or than alive. And God says to him, what right do you have to be angry? Well, that's anger and blaming God. Or we can feel sorry for ourselves. Question, so oftentimes we hear people saying when trouble comes, why me? Why me? The story is told in Genesis 42 about the 10 sons of Jacob who, during a famine, head off to Egypt and go to get food from Egypt. They don't know that the prime minister of Egypt is their young brother Joseph, whom they had sold into slavery some 15 years before. And as the prime minister, Joseph asks for the brothers to bring back his own youngest brother, Benjamin, though they don't know that they are brothers, the prime minister and Benjamin. And he imprisons one of the brothers, Simeon, and sends them back to Canaan. And we find Reuben saying to Jacob the father, then the man who is Lord over the land said to us, this is how I will know whether you are honest men. Leave one of your brothers here with me, Laban and Simeon, and take food for your starving households and go. But bring your youngest brother to me, so I will know you are not spies, but honest men. Then I will give your brother back to you, and you can trade in the land. And when they tell this to Jacob, Jacob's response is this, you have deprived me of my children. He says this to the 10 oldest brothers, his sons. Joseph is no more. Of course, he doesn't know that he's the prime minister, but he thinks he's dead. Simeon is no more. Well, Simeon's in Egypt in jail. And now you want to take Benjamin? And then notice the next statement, everything is against me. In other words, it's a way of saying, why me? Why me? Well, he was, as we sometimes put it, having a pity party, sitting on the pity pot. Why me? Well, we often ask that. Lord, why me? Why did this happen to me? Recently, one of my wife's and my very, very good friends, Chris, was diagnosed with inoperable cancer. And she said to us that she had decided instead of asking why me, to rather ask why not me? Well, sadly, we have to report that she passed away into the presence of her Lord 2 weeks ago. And God, in his gracious wisdom, chose her to take her home. Her work was done, and he took her home. Well, the fourth and final response that we can have, or perhaps there's more than that, but the only four that I'm going to look at, is that we get discouraged and feel like quitting, throwing the towel in. The story of Job in the book of Job tells how that one day the enemies of the Israelites, the Sabians, attack. They steal all of Job's oxen and donkeys. And right after that, Job is told that lightning strikes and kills all his sheep. And shortly after that, he is told that a raiding party of Chaldeans came and took all his camels. And while he's being told that, a fourth man comes and says, your sons and daughters have been killed in a windstorm that destroyed the house they were in. Well, you can imagine, in a split second, he loses everything he has, including his 10 precious children. And in chapter 3 of the book of Job, Job says this, why did I not perish at birth and die as I came from the womb? In chapter 4, Eliphaz, one of Job's three friends who had come to comfort him, responds by saying this to him, think how you have instructed many, how you have strengthened feeble hands. Your words have supported those who stumbled. You have strengthened faltering knees. But now trouble comes to you, and you are discouraged. It strikes you, and you're dismayed. And so discouragement and saying, I can't go on. I don't want to go on. I want to drop out. Bill Gothard says, discouragement is a result of failing a test we know God has brought into our lives. Well, each of these responses I've looked at will cause us to fail in what that statement was made in the book, Good to Great, the hardiness factor, the quote that I had earlier on by James Collins, the people who made the experience their they were permanently dispirited by that event, those who got their life back to normal, and those who used the experience as a defining event that made them stronger. Sir Henry Lotter writes this, in a time like this, there are three courses open to a man. He may give way to despair, sour upon the world, and become a grouch. He may endeavor to drown his sorrow in drink or in a life of waywardness and wickedness, or he may turn to God. And Lauder said that after he had heard his son had been killed in World War I. Well, James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4, our text says this, consider it pure joy, my brothers, when you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith develops perseverance, and perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So the way to look at our troubles, according to James, the right way is to look at troubles with pure joy. James 1:2, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds. The contemporary English version translates it this way: "My friends, be glad, even if you have a lot of trouble." The Living Bible translates it: "Dear brothers, is your life full of difficulties and temptations? Then be happy." The J.B. Phillips translation says it, puts it this way: "When all kinds of trials and temptations crowd into your lives, my brothers, don't resent them as intruders, but welcome them as friends." Now, I know if you're listening to those verses, you may be thinking, like, hey, what's going on here? Is this some sort of a attempt to put a positive spin on some very negative things in life? Like, consider it pure joy? Be glad? Be happy? Welcome them as friends? Like, are we trying to talk ourselves into believing something bad that really isn't all that bad after all? Well, it's true. You know, often we usually associate words like sorrow and sadness when we think of troubles. We don't think trouble, and we don't, the word joy doesn't jump to our minds, or glad or happy or welcome. Like the parents of the little boy who were very worried that their son was, the little boy growing up was so optimistic and he saw everything so positively, they took him to a psychiatrist. So in an attempt to dampen the boy's spirits, the psychiatrist took him to a room piled high with horse manure, but instead of displaying distaste, the little boy climbed to the top of the pile and he began digging in it. And the psychiatrist asked him, he said, "What are you doing?" And the little boy responded, he said, "With all this manure, there must be a pony in here somewhere." Well, that kind of positive thinking is not necessarily what James is talking about here. So, what is so great about having your faith tested that we should be so joyful over it? And the reason we can count it pure joy is in the text says, because we know that these tough times are what God is using as part of testing our faith. Today, the English Standard Version translates it, "For you know that the testing of your faith," you have to realize there's an association between the tough times and the testing. The two are connected in your life. You're going through a tough time, always think testing. The two are interrelated. The tough times are allowed to come into our lives by God to test our faith. And for sure, God will test our faith by allowing various trials into our lives, be they health issues, financial stress, marriage struggles, relationship breakdowns, all sorts of problems. And when he allows these to come into our lives, then he watches how we respond to those problems. And he's looking at our response. He's watching. How's she going to respond to this problem? As someone has put it, an untried faith is of no value. Because you see, nothing more accurately shows what we truly are, and that is at the core of our beings, than the way that it is we respond to the various trials and difficulties that life throws at us. I like the way Chip Morgan puts it. He says this: "Christians are like tea bags. You don't know what they're really like until you put them into hot water." You see, what it is that when you go through a trial, you really find out who you really are, the real you. I don't know the real you when things are going good, but I do know you, the real you, when things are going bad. For that reason, I like the way Eugene Peterson, in his paraphrase of the New Testament, James chapter 1, verse 3, puts it this way: "You know that under pressure, your faith life is forced into the open and shows its true colors." See, that tea bag remains in its bag and you have no idea until it's put in hot water. And then all of a sudden becomes a appetizing drink to drink. You see, the reason that God puts us through tests is because he wants to develop perseverance in us. Verse 3 says, "Because you know the testing of your faith develops perseverance." The word perseverance in Greek is hupomonein. I put there the Greek letters as well as a transliteration of it into English. And hupomonein literally means a patient enduring. And it can be translated and is variously translated by words in English such as perseverance, endurance, steadfastness, or patience. Any one of those words in English, perseverance, endurance, steadfastness, patience, will accurately reflect hupomone. And so that's what happens. After we go through some tough times, we find ourselves getting stronger. We develop perseverance. 1 Peter 5:10, and the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. And so that when we are going through these tough times and the testing that is putting us through, we need to understand that they have been sent to us by God to develop perseverance, endurance, patience, steadfastness in us. In other words, if you don't go through tough times, how else will you develop it? You can't develop it unless you go. You can't develop perseverance, endurance, steadfastness, and patience unless you do go through tough times. I remember reading about a young pastor who wanted to learn patience, so he asked an older pastor to pray for him. And the older pastor bowed his head and prayed. He said, "Lord, please send my young brother here a whole lot of problems into his life." Well, the young pastor stopped the old pastor and he said, "Hey, wait a minute. I wanted you to pray for patience. Here you're praying for problems for me." And the old pastor said, "Well, how else do you think God is going to teach you patience?" Let me ask you this question. Would you learn patience in a world where nothing ever went wrong? I like the way Paul puts it in Romans 5, 3 and 4. Trouble produces patience, and patience produces character, and character produces hope. In other words, no trouble, usually no patience. 2 Corinthians 4:17, "For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all." You see, this is the way God works. When he wants to develop the character of peace in our lives, he'll put us into chaos. If he wants to develop the character of patience in us, he'll make us wait. And those attempts, let me put it this way, those acts by God produce the desired effect he wants through using the trials and the troubles. I like this cartoon. The fellow saying to the pastor at the end of the church service, "Great message on patience, pastor. I love the way you illustrated it by telling those kids in the back to sit down and shut up." Well, you see, when you go through a trial and you respond to it in a God-honoring way, it helps you build your spiritual muscles. It's like going to the gym, and you start out working out, you're skinny and scrawny, and then you start pumping that iron, and before you know it, you've become muscular and well-built. And that's the way it is spiritually. When you go through one trial and you respond to it properly and in a God-honoring way, the next trial, you're just a bit stronger. And then the next one, you're a bit stronger and stronger and stronger. And until you get to the place where you're, we'll see, fully mature and complete, as it talks about later on in the verse. Now, the next thing that James will say is that we have to endure until the testing is over. As I said before, one of the temptations we oftentimes going through troubles is that we want to give up and quit. And that's why he says in verse 4, perseverance must finish its work. We want to quit and to throw in the towel when things go difficult. The Living Bible translates it, "So let it grow. Don't try to squirm out of your problems, for when your patience is finally in full bloom, you'll be ready for anything, strong in character, full and complete." The Message. So don't try to get out of anything prematurely. Let it do its work so you may become mature and well-developed, not deficient in any way. You see, the sad reality is far too many Christians decide to throw the towel in when the going gets rough. And when they're going through the testing of their faith, they do not see it as the testing of their faith. They just see it as a problem in their life. And they walk away and they say, "That's it." We see this happening in the lives of some of the disciples during Jesus' ministry here on earth. In John 6:60, upon hearing this, many of his disciples said, "This is a hard teaching. Who can accept it?" And it goes on to say, "And from this time, many of his disciples turned back and no longer followed him." You see, for some, the testing of their faith is just too much. And that's why Hebrews 10:38 warns us. It says, "The people God accepts will live because of their faith, but he isn't pleased with anyone who turns back." Shortly after I became a pastor, I was visiting in the home of a lady in our church. She'd recently started coming to church and made a profession of faith in Christ. But after she had taken that step of faith in Christ, a whole series of bad things started happening to her. And as I was talking with her, she was commiserating about some of these problems she was going through. And she said, you know, this Christian life is harder than I ever expected it to be. And she then went on to say, as a matter of fact, she said to me, I wish I'd never met you. That didn't make me feel too terribly good. Well, it was shortly after that that she quit coming to church and never returned. Sad reality. Just threw in the towel. You know, one of the places that God most uses to test our faith is in that relationship in life that we call marriage. You know, every marriage starts out with the highest of expectations. People think, man, when I get married, everything is just going to be peachy keen. It's going to be perfect. Problems are over. But then, you know, you get married and you start living together and you find out that that gorgeous woman that you married there at the altar takes that toothpaste, like the gorgeous woman I married at the altar a number of years ago, and squeezes it in the middle. That handsome dude that she marries, she finds every evening he wants to watch sports on TV, although during COVID-19, not much sports to watch, guys. And so before you know it, there's conflict, and they're facing each other back to back and asking themselves, why did I ever marry her? What was I thinking of when I said yes to his proposal? Perhaps you heard about the very unhappy wife who dragged her husband to a marriage counselor, and she wanted to save their flagging marriage. And the counselor listened to her as she went on and on about her husband's failure to love her. He said, he never tells me he loves me. And so finally the counselor had heard enough, and he asked the husband, he said, are you willing to do whatever it takes to save your marriage? And the fellow said, no, yes I am. Then he said, you need to do this. And with that, the counselor stood to his feet. He went to the woman, pulled her up from the chair that she was sitting in, and he put his arms around her and gave her a long, lingering kiss. Well, the husband stared in amazement, and the wife was astounded. And then the counselor finished the kiss, turned to the husband and said, if you want to save your marriage, your wife needs this at least twice a week. And the husband, still stunned, stammered out, well, I guess I can bring her in Tuesdays and Thursdays. You notice I've got the laughter through the marvels of technology. I was able to capture on tape your laughing and all the computers and bring it back and inserting it as you're laughing right now. Anyways, back to something a little more seriously. You see, God knows in marriage, for example, that those relationships with the greatest differences between them also have the greatest potential for growth. You see, when you're married to somebody who's constantly rubbing you in the wrong direction, it's actually God's intention to do so, because he develops the fruit of the Spirit in our lives by allowing us to be with people who tempt us to express the opposite quality. In other words, you may think, why in the world did God put me with that woman and she just drives me around the bend? And God will say, because I want you to learn patience. You would never learn patience if she wasn't the way she was. And that's why Romans 3 and 4, 5, 3 and 4 put it, not only this, but we rejoice in our sufferings because we know suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance, character, and character, hope. You see, if you and I need to learn to love, excuse me, he will put us with unlovely people. Now, it's easy to love lovely people. The challenge is loving those who are unlovely. In other words, how am I ever going to learn how to love if I'm surrounded only by lovely people? That's why Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, if you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Even the tax collectors are doing that. In other words, everybody does that. Everybody's nice to the people that are nice. It's easy to do that. If you greet only your brothers, what are you doing more than others? Even pagans do that. It's normal. Even sinful humans respond that way. And so, as someone has put it, you learn to be loving by being with unlovely people. Eugene Peterson, The Message, puts it, if all you do is love the lovable, do you expect a bonus? Anybody can do that. If you simply say hello to those who greet you, do you expect a medal? Any run-of-the-mill sinner does that. In other words, you haven't done anything noteworthy out of that by simply loving the lovely. You need to love the unlovely. And when the difficult times come, like in your marriage right now, you're going through a tough time right now. When those difficult times come, you learn, this is how God is shaping me, working on me. Yet tragically, instead of learning to love the unlovely, many people, including some so-called Christians, just walk out of their marriage and divorce. And they say, I'm out of here. She's too unlovable, unlovely. And thereby arresting the wonderful plan of spiritual growth and development God had for them. I see that tragedy repeated over and over again. How many marriages where spiritual growth could have happened end up in the divorce courts? The story is told of a man one day walking down a path who saw a butterfly cocoon that was about to open. And as he watched, a small opening appeared in the cocoon. The man sat and watched the butterfly for several hours as it struggled to force its body through that little hole. And then it seemed to stop making any progress. It appeared as if it had gotten as far as it could go no further. So the man decided to help the butterfly. He took a pair of scissors and opened the cocoon. And the butterfly then emerged easily. But it had a withered body, it was tiny, and its wings were shriveled. The man continued to watch because he expected that at any moment the wings would open, enlarge, and expand to be able to support the butterfly's body. But neither happened. In fact, the butterfly spent the rest of its life crawling around with a withered body and shriveled wings. It never was able to take flight. What the man, in his kindness and goodwill, did not understand was that the restricting cocoon and the struggle required for the butterfly to get through the tiny opening were nature's way of forcing fluid from the body of the butterfly into the wings so that it would be ready for flight once more, once it achieved its freedom from the cocoon. And then it concludes with this statement, sometimes struggles are exactly what we need in our life. If we were allowed to go through our life without obstacles, it would cripple us. We would not be as strong as we could have been, never able to fly. I call it arrested development. And that's why James says, consider it pure joy, my brothers, whenever you face trials of many kinds, because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance, and perseverance must finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. So you see, if instead of throwing in the towel and walking away, we choose rather to see this trouble as being sent by God to test us, and then we decide to let him finish what he's begun, it is then that we'll see the rich fruit of his plans for us. As Peter puts it in 1 Peter 1:7, the proof of your faith being more precious than gold, which is perishable, even though tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor. You see, God's ultimate goal for allowing us to be tested by troubles is that you may be mature and complete. The Greek word for mature is teleos, and it has a sense of perfect, mature, arriving at that place, ideally where you should be. And the word complete, olakara, let me say that again. Olokleroi means that it's complete in all its parts, nothing wanting, complete in all respects. And really, the goal of our Christian lives is to hear God say to us, well done, you're now mature and complete. And you know, when you hear God say that to you, that's pure joy. That's why Hebrews 10 says, do not throw away your confidence, it will be richly rewarded. You need to persevere, so that when you've done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. Well, I want to wrap it up by giving this reassurance. Always remember that when you are going through troubles in life and you're wondering, and maybe you're thinking that right now, God, where are you? Always remember, he's right there. Someone has put it this way, the presence of trouble does not mean the absence of God. God is there with you right now. He's not leaving you alone. He's accomplishing his purposes. He's working for your good. He's predestined you to become conformed to look like Jesus. That's why you're going through what you're going. And you know, never forget that trials in the Christian life are the fire that refines the gold. And pure gold really has all of the impurities burned out. Later on in his life, Job will come to that statement. Earlier on, he's wishing he had never been born. And it says, but he knows the way I take. When he has tested me, I will come forth as gold. As Madame Guyon puts us, it is the fire of suffering that brings forth the gold of godliness. They say that the royal palace in Tehran, Iran, is breathtakingly beautiful. That when you step into that palace, you're surrounded by an amazing, sparkling environment. It appears, they say, that as if the ceilings and the walls, columns, are all covered with diamonds. And here is how that all happened. When the palace was being planned, architects had ordered mirrors to cover the entrance walls. But when the mirrors arrived in transit, it found that they had all been broken. And they were just simply, literally, thousands of pieces of smashed mirrors. Well, they were going to get rid of them all, but one creative man said, "Nope. You know, maybe it'll be more beautiful because they are broken." And what that man did and his workers, they took the pieces and fitted them together in a mosaic. And today the palace is beautiful beyond words, awash with sparkling rainbow diamond colors. And that same kind of beauty will be yours too, as the results of the trials that you've gone through, or maybe that you're going through right now. God is making something beautiful out of your life.